Hi, welcome back. Today we're going over arbitrary filter shapes for convolution 2D. Yeah, that's right, not rectangular convolution. So take a look at this 5. I think you'll notice that it is hexagonal. Yeah, is that a word? So this is the filter here that we're going to use. Notice it's not a rectangle. And notice that this 5 is not a rectangle. It's made of hex grids, like here and here, and oh my gosh, another one there. Yeah, so we'll make this neural net, we'll go through it, and we'll show how it creates these filters. And yeah, we'll make this custom convolution filter. And this all came from a Stack Overflow question asked a couple years ago. I answered it in Tensorflow 1.4 using Python 2, and I thought I'd update it to use Keras. So let's get into the code. So this is a Python notebook on Colab. If you haven't used Colab, I've used it in my other videos. It's pretty nice. You can use a GPU right in the cloud for free. I'll put a link in the description. Okay, so let's go through this. We're just gonna import some basic things, TensorFlow, NumPy, Matplotlib, and then let's take a look at the Stack Overflow code. You can see the outline here. So the Stack Overflow code, this is the updated code for it to work in Python 3 with TensorFlow 2. And what we're talking about here is, you know, we have this imaginary image. It's just a range of 0 to 24. And we create a kernel and this mask. So in the Stack Overflow post, I proposed making a mask where it's just the outline in the center, and you can't learn anything from this middle area. So it's kind of like a donut. And if we run this, we can see that we definitely get two different results. Okay, so this is a pretty small example, and it doesn't use the modern whole Keras thing. So let's take this up a notch. Let's take a look at MNIST handwritten digits. Let's import that data and show a nice image of what those handwritten digits look like. Let's take this first 5 here and let's hexify it. So we're going to increase it a bit and convert it into more of a hex pattern. This is just the code to do it. We can close that down. I'll put a link to this code if you're interested. You can check it out in the description. All right, so there's that 5, and it's just been exploded into a hex pattern. As you can see, this is the filter that we want to make, and we want to then apply this filter through convolution across this image. In this image, you can see that there's, you know, this hex kind of thing going on with it. And we don't want to take a square, we want to take a nice hex. So imagine this filter here being applied to this area here. So how could we do that if we have some data that's in a hex format? Well, something that we could do is we could just like shift this row over just a little bit and shift this row over just a little bit and so on and so on. But we have to do the same thing and be cognizant of our filter. So let's take a look at that. So here we've shifted it over just by like 1 pixel, and you can see it's the filter is just, you know, bending a little bit, and our 5 is just bending a little bit. But if we take a look at this filter and take a look at how it fits into the front here, we'll notice that it's exactly the same pixels that the filter would match here, this filter. And this first few pixels, they match up real nice. Okay, so that's 1 pixel. Let's shift it all over one more pixel. And here we go, one more pixel. And this is definitely recognizable as a 5. And this is now what our filter looks like. And if we line it up to these pixels, it's the same pixels as we had up above. And so this is what our filter needs to look like in order to go over a hex grid. We need to make sure that we block out and we don't use these two pixels here and only use these pixels. All right, so let's make a custom filter that only is allowed to do convolution using this kind of filter, is not allowed to take information from here or here, and see if we can apply this to MNIST. Spoiler alert, we can. Okay, hex filter. So this is basically, you know, the numeric representation of that filter, right? So we want to allow information from there, allow information from here, and allow information from here, and block it from these two areas. And this just defines our filter. That's this guy here. And we can make this really any shape. Now, if you're familiar with filters, or rather kernels in two-dimensional convolutions, you need to have what the filter is in the first two dimensions, that's this, and then the input number of filters and the output number of filters, or layers rather, input layers and output layers. And since we're just going to broadcast this across the whole kernel, we can just put that as one and one, and that works out just fine. Let's run that. Okay, let's get into the Keras implementation. First thing we're going to do is we are going to write a custom filter. So I'm going to go over this at a pretty high level. Feel free to come back and take a look at the code to get a deeper understanding. But this is the basic basic Keras custom layer. We extend Keras layer, and we have an initialization, how we need to build that layer, and what happens when we call that layer. So we're just going to allow to be able to specify the number of output layers and the padding. We're going to figure out the number of input layers dynamically from when it builds. And here we specify a kernel. We have to create our own kernel. We can't use convolution 2D as is as a layer. So we just specify our own kernel, and we specify some offset. So this is like, you know, the B of MXB. This is the kernel, and then this is just the offset. And we're actually going to bundle in MaxPool into our convolution. It's going to be convolution 2D with our custom filter and pooling. So this is our convolution here. We have our input. We take our kernel and we multiply it by our hex filter. And since our hex filter has zeros here, it zeroes out the data that's in the filter, does not allow any information that's in the filter that's in those locations to be able to pass through. And also when backprop comes in, it can't modify the kernel because that information is destroyed. And so the backpropagation will not update those areas in the kernel. Okay, so that's pretty much it. Then we take that convolution, we add the offset, and we're going to use 10H as our activation function, and then we do max pool. So that's our custom Keras layer. Okay, let's actually build our model. So our model is going to be pretty straightforward. We're just going to use a sequential model, but we are not going to actually use it. We're going to do the model sequentially. Here, I do it here instead of using the model sequential. And what we're going to do is we're going to create each of the different layers without attaching it to the previous, so that later in the video at the bottom, we can go in, we can inspect the weights pretty easily. Okay, so we have our input 28 by 28. We're just going to reshape that because we need that extra layer there. We're going to do convolution, that our convolution 2D filtered pool. We're going to, so what that's going to do is it's going to reduce it to a 14 by 14 image. Then this next one, we're going to increase the number of output filters by 28, then it'll be a 6 by 6. I always do that a couple times, we flatten it, throw it through some 200 hidden units, or rather one hidden layer with 200 units, and then our output is just going to be sigmoid. And then we attach it all together, and then we make the model. Let's do that, and let's just graph that model. So this is what it looks like. The input layer is 28 by 28, and the first convolution reduces it down to 14 by 14 with 16 features, and then 6 by 6 with 28 features, 3 by 3, and so on and so on. Okay, let's try training this. It's training pretty well. Okay, there we go. It finished. 95% on the evaluation. I mean, that's not... The point of this isn't to make like a super awesome image recognition. It was just to show that we can create that type of filter. You know, a larger filter would definitely be better. Okay, so... let's confirm that the filter worked. We want to make sure that our model didn't update the parts of the kernel that were filtered. So let's do a numeric inspection. Let's just rerun this. I think we have different values. Yeah. So here we're taking a look at that that first convolution and the kernel value. And the reason we can do that is because we defined it like this. So here's our first convolution, and we're just inspecting this kernel value here. So convert it to a NumPy and take a look at that one of the filters, the third filter, as a matter of fact. And we can see that it's 0 and 0. That's great. Let's just take another look at another one. Let's say like 6. And again, it's 0 and 0. Let's do a graphical inspection. So in this graphic inspection, what we're going to do is we're going to do the absolute value of each of those kernels, so the 3x3 kernels. And there's 16 kernels on this layer, 16 filters of 3x3. So here they all are, and we're doing the absolute value. So any filter that has a zero value will be black, and all the rest will have some other color. And we can see, sure enough, the top and the bottom, the upper right and the lower left corner of each filter is zeroed out. And there we have it. Arbitrary filters, a custom Keras layer to do it in TensorFlow 2, and it's able to actually learn how to categorize digits. Hope you enjoyed the video. I'll see you next time.